right now using the Hubble telescope is that it's a whirlpool galaxy. It's a whirlpool galaxy. But when they zoom in that whirlpool galaxy, in the middle of that galaxy is a cross. And it signifies the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, amazingly, we don't understand why, but the Bible tells us the heaven declares the glory of God. It only proves that when people does not believe in God, and then we go outside and look upon the stars, and look upon the heavens, and look upon the skies, God is very evident according to the scripture. By just looking on the nature, God reveals in the heart of many people that there is a God. That is the reason why, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, in Romans chapter 1, the Bible tells us, He put it in every conscience, in every heart of all the people, that He is existing. That is the reason when, you know, even though during the time of the nomads, you know, they would create their own gods. They would make the moon as their gods. They would make the sun as their god. They would make the elephant as their god. They try to invent God because in their heart, they know that there is a God. And that is how awesome it is to understand that we who are here, you know, are experiencing the love of God to the max. To the max. You know, last month we talked about loving God. That is our theme. Loving God. And we defined that if we are falling in love with the Lord, if we love God, the first thing is that we become what? A follower. So, I am not a fan, I am not a cheerleader, but I am a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen? Amen. So, if we declare that we are a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, we should fall in love with God every single day in our lives. And when we fall in love with God, it reflects to the people. Okay? It reflects to the people. That's the reason why first Sunday of February, we talk about love should begin where? Where? At home. It should be practiced first at home. The love of God that we have experienced in our lives should be practiced first in our home. You know, we tend to neglect this. We practice love outside the home, but inside the home, our patience and our long-suffering and our temper is very short. And that's crazy. That is crazy, right? It's supposed to be the love, the unconditional love, the long-suffering and the understanding should be first practiced at home. You know, it transcends outside the home. And then last Sunday, we talk about love is difficult, love is easy. Now, church, what is God's principle? God is what? God is love. So whether it's difficult to love someone, or it's easy to love someone, whatever the situation is, we have to practice love. And tonight, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, we're going to talk about love that makes a difference. Love that makes a difference. You know, I promised you last Sunday that I'm going to talk about loving the unlovable, but we're reserving it for next week. Okay, reserving it for next week. I'm going to allow Brother Arvin to recover from his surgery, because Brother Arvin is the one speaking for loving the unlovable. Okay, he had his surgery yesterday on his meniscus and his knee, and I'm going to pray for him, that he would be able to stand up this coming Sunday, because I won't be here. This will be my last Sunday in the church. Okay. This will be my last Sunday, because after this Sunday, next Sunday, Brother Arthur will be speaking, and then I depart going to the Philippines for our mission trip. Our mission trip. You know? And just to let you know, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, this is how the mission trip is going to be. Mission trip is out of love for other people. Okay? In this church, we're bringing in $6,000 for a livelihood program. Meaning to say, we already have pre-selected families in the churches that were going in those areas that were affected by the Haiyan typhoon. There will be 4 in Coron, there will be 4 in Nunguswaga, and each family would receive about 10,000 to 12,500 pesos. And then when we fly to Ilocos yesterday, okay, there was a move by some of the pastors that the entire $15,000 will be brought home to the Philippines to build worship buildings that were affected by Haiyan typhoon. That is excluding the $7,960 that Calvary Bible Church have donated to our church to be used for the Messiah Baptist Church rebuilding of the worship center. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? For such a small church like ours, if you sum up all those money, I couldn't count it by my hand. You multiply it by 43 or by 44, just imagine the influence that we would be able to make back home in the Philippines alone. You know? So I want you to pray for that. Now, if you want to join me, you know, we have a full schedule when we go home to the Philippines. We have a full schedule. I'm arriving there February 28th. March 1, we already have the church management system seminar for our church plant and church leaders. You know, we already paid for the church management system. It was supposed to be $2,400 for the year. They cut it into half to accommodate us. I want you to understand what is a church management system. A church management system is used by mega churches back home in the Philippines and here as well. And they pay thousands of dollars for that. But there was a good company who extended that to us. Here we would be able to monitor everything. For such a petite church like us, God has entrusted us with a big work. So if you want to go with me, you still have a chance. We have still 2 weeks. Still have 2 weeks for those who would like to come. You know, I challenge you to invest in making a difference to the lives of other people. Just like the topic for tonight, love that makes a difference. Now, what is love that makes a difference? Mahatma Gandhi said this. It is the action, not the fruit of the action, that's important. You have to do the right thing. It may not be in your power, may not be in your time, that there will be any fruit of what you're going to do. But that doesn't mean you stop doing the right thing. You may never know what results come from your action, but if you do nothing, that is where the catch is, if you do nothing, there will be no result. Do you agree with that? That is true, actually, right? The cause and effect. So if you do nothing, there's nothing. Just like the Big Bang Theory. There's nothing. What is going to explode? Nothing. That is the reason why Big Bang Theory is not true. Because there's nothing from the beginning. And then, Ralph Waldo Emerson, who is a good friend of mine, he said, the purpose of life is not to be happy. Although one of the laws in our constitution is what? The pursuit of happiness. But he said, life is not to be happy, it is to be what? To be useful, to be honorable, to be compassionate, to help it make some difference that you have lived and live well. Now, church, from the beginning of time, there is a pursuit of purpose to make a difference. I don't know about you, but what is your purpose in life? What do you think are you seeking in life? Do you want to make a difference in life? do you want to leave a mark? Like Mark, who left a mark last night in Project Overflow, New York? Making a difference, or make a difference, is defined like this. It means to have a significant effect. It means to have a significant effect. So the question here, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, is, do I want to make a difference? What is my purpose in life? What kind of difference can I leave as a legacy of my life? You know, all of us are given years to live. Some of us will be given 80, 90, 100, the most is 120. Some of us will live short. As you have seen what happened last week, you know, I was actually asking other guys from the church, what if all those people who went home to be with the Lord knew each other? Right? The mother of Kuya RD, the mother of Ate Army, Ate Marina, the father of Tata Romeo, and the Lola of the grandmother of Ate Hen. What if they knew each other personally? And they saw each other in heaven, and they will be in a conversation saying, what are you doing here? I thought you were in Hawaii. Right? Hey, what are you doing here? And then all of a sudden, they will see the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hey, watch out, yo. Like, Jesus Christ is a homie. Watch out. Well, you're in heaven already. Why? Because in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, the Bible tells us, it is appointed unto man once to die, after this is what? It's judgment. Meaning to say, when we die, there will be judgment. When we were born, death is already in us. You cannot avoid, nobody can avoid death. You know, an actor, probably Akiana knows him, Roy Alvarez. An actor in the Philippines died suddenly, doesn't have sickness. Doesn't have a heart disease, he doesn't have a diabetes, doesn't have this, he doesn't have that, all of a sudden he died. Or from a fatal heart attack, all of a sudden. What is happening? The issue here, my brothers and sisters, is that when that time comes, when our due date comes, what would be the legacy that we're going to leave? What difference were we able to make in the lives of our loved ones or in the lives of our friends? I'm not talking about making a difference in the world. Got it? Are you mad? Okay, I'll be done in 15. See that? What's the time? 5:45. I want you to look at that watch. 5:45. By 6, I'm done. This will be the shortest message sermon that you are going to hear tonight. I promise. Now, if by 6 o'clock I'm not done yet, I'm going to continue. Okay? Now, when I was asking the Lord, you know, making a difference in life, like, how can I preach this? Like, how can I share to my loved ones and to my brothers and sisters in the Lord, you know, what kind of a difference we can make? And tonight, I'd like to present to you Romans chapter 5, my brothers and sisters. Open your Bibles, please, in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 11, and I would like to present to you a total package of making a difference. A total package of making a difference. Romans chapter 5. One of my favorite topics is Romans chapter 5. Because I believe that Romans chapter 5 gives us a complete package of what kind of difference we can make in the life of a person. Now, are you familiar with the definition of a friend in the book of Proverbs? No? 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 How are you familiar with the definition of a friend? A friend loves at all time. Now, if you love your friend, you won't allow your friend to be in the danger zone, right? Is that right? Do you agree with that? Do you agree with that? Now we're going to go around that and try to understand. Have you found it? Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. If you found it, can you raise your hand? Okay, now in our PowerPoint, it's over here. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. I'm going to read it with you, but I want you to follow me as I read it. Okay, as I read it, because here we're going to understand what kind of difference that God wants us to do. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have, I'm not going to go out of Romans chapter 5, okay? I'm going to deal with Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. That is the reason why I'm going to be done soon. Don't take off your sandals. This is going to be fast. Okay? This is going to be fast. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand, and we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance, and endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us, because He has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with His love. When we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us. Now, most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person who is especially good. Here is the context, and we're going to start with the context. Verse 8 and 9. But God showed His great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still, can you read that? While we were still sinners. Now look at verse 8 again. But God showed His what? His great love for us by what? By sending His Son. Okay, verse 9. And since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, He will certainly save us from God's condemnation. Now, if you have your printed Bibles with you, I want you to encircle that condemnation, because that condemnation is the object of hell. Okay? For since our friendship with God was restored by the death of His Son, while we were still His enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of His Son. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God, because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends of God. Number one, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, making a difference. I'm going to go into a progression. I'm going to start with the context. The Bible tells us it is love that saved me. It is love that saved me. Look at verse 6. Look at verse 6 and verse 8 and 9. Now, here's the issue here, my brothers and sisters in the Lord. In the scripture that we have read, this is my condition. My condition is what? I am helpless. I am a sinner, and I am condemned. That is the condition of a man without the Lord Jesus Christ. That is what we call total depravity of man. The Bible tells us all of us have sinned and fall short to the glory of God. Meaning we are hopeless. We are sinners. And we cannot save ourselves. But the Bible tells us is this in verse 6. When we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. But God showed His great love for us by sending Christ to die for us. Look at this, my brothers and sisters in the Lord. What compels God the Father for me to be saved is not because I am a good person. It's not because I do a lot of good works. It is not because I help a lot of people. But But what compels God the Father for me to be saved is because of His great love for me and great love for you. Now we have to understand that love is the one that drives the Father to send the Lord Jesus Christ so that the Lord Jesus Christ will save us and will die and will pay for our sins. It was anchored through love. It was made because God loves us so much in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Now the Bible tells us that He died for us while we were yet sinners. Will you die for someone that is your enemy? Of course not. Probably you can die for someone who's good at you or good with you, but you're not going to die for someone that hates you. And you hate too. It's come on, let's be honest, right? But the Lord Jesus Christ here said, God the Father said, He died, He was sent, though we were sinners. So it is the love of God. You know, if we fail to understand that the reason why we are here tonight, the reason that we can worship, the reason why we clap our hands, the reason why we became a believer of the Lord Jesus Christ is because of His unfailing love to all of us, we won't be able to grow spiritually. We are not going to take Christianity seriously because we fail to understand that it was the love of the Father that sent the Lord Jesus Christ so that when I die, when that my due date come, I will go to heaven. And that is love. Just imagine you and me, the object of God's love, even though it is not, or we are not, deserving. It is love that saves me. It is not because of me. It is not because we're good people. Number two, it is love that makes me right in His sight. Look at the verse that it says here. Verse 1. So I use verse 6, 7, and 8 as the context. Then I'm going to support now the study starting in verse 1. It says here, therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight, by what? By faith. Okay? By faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ, our Lord, has done for us. Now listen, church, I want you to listen to this. Okay? I want you to listen to this. What is the difference between peace of God and peace with God? What's the difference? Those who are good in English. What is the difference between peace with God and the peace of God? The peace of God, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, the one that we experience deep within. You know, the calmness that we experience. But peace with God means we're no longer enemies with God. There is a treaty. Like peace with you. So we're no longer fighting. We're no longer enemies, but we have peace. Now listen, church. It can only happen by putting our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now putting the faith in the Lord Jesus Christ on what? On what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us. And what is that doing? That is, the Lord Jesus Christ came, crucified, died, buried, and resurrected. That is the message of the gospel. When the Lord Jesus Christ did it for us, all we have to do is put that faith to the Lord Jesus Christ who died for us. And the Bible tells us we have peace with God. Now, in theological term, this is what you call justification. We are being justified by the Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of the Father. So the picture is like this. The judge is God the Father. I've done this many times, if you still remember, right? The judge is God the Father. The accuser or the prosecutor is Satan. The defense lawyer is the Lord Jesus Christ. And we are the accused. Okay? We are the accused. Now when Satan goes to the Father and starts to accuse Reuel, to accuse Arman, that he's not a good person, the Lord Jesus Christ comes in and he will say to the Father, Dad, I saved him. He put his faith on what I have done on the cross. What do you think the Father will say? Even Satan will accuse us day and night. The Father will say, oh, sorry, Satan, but this one, the Lord Jesus Christ, you know, he got this. He got this. You have no case against this person, because when I look at this person, I do not see his sins. Remember 1 Corinthians a while ago? He doesn't have a bad record, because I see the holiness of the Lord Jesus Christ in him. He is hiding behind the holiness of the Lord Jesus Christ. And because of that, we are not at war. I am not going to condemn him. He is now justified because of the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 5, verse 1, it is God who makes us right in his sight. It is not because we're good people. It is not because we give a lot of things. It is not because we help a lot of people. But we become right in the sight of God through the Lord Jesus Christ. And it is God the Father who sent Jesus Christ so that rightness will happen. It will occur, not because of us. Number three, it is love that gives me the privilege to be peace with God. And therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ, our Lord, has done for us. We are no longer object of wrath because of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at this, my brothers and sisters. And we're talking about making a difference. The first difference that God gave us is to send the Lord Jesus Christ because of love. And because of that love, we're no longer condemned. And because of that love, we're saved. And because of that love, we have peace with God. And because of that love, we are changed people. Number four, it is love that gives me the privilege to enjoy God's glory. You know, as I was saying, this is a total package, and you'll see why. In verse 2, because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place. Now, I want you to make notice of this. What is this? Undeserved privilege. Let us paraphrase it into one word. What do you think is undeserved privilege is all about? It's called grace. It's called grace. We didn't work for it. It is not our privilege. We're undeserving for that. But the Bible tells us, because of our faith, when we put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, you know, the Bible tells us, we're privileged where we now stand, and we confidently and joyfully, what is this? Look forward to sharing God's glory. So we're looking forward to share God's glory. What is this? Is this a place here on earth? No. This is a place in heaven. Not only that the Lord Jesus Christ, not only the Father, is the one that initiated for you and for me to be saved. Not only that the love of the Father compels him to make us right in his sight, but he also gave us a hope that when that time comes that we die, we look forward for a place called heaven and rejoice in that place. You know, I've been trying to study what is the picture of heaven. I've been trying to study, Lord, what is heaven is all about? Lord, what is this God's glory? You know, in the God's glory sometimes is being used by a Shekinah. I was trying to understand, Lord, what is heaven? But there is no exact explanation that I can tell you how awesome it is aside from the Bible. When the Bible tells us that the heaven is a place of glory, that everything that we treasure here on earth is just actually a display in heaven. It's not important in heaven. Like we treasure gold in heaven, you walk on gold. We treasure emerald, jade, those precious gems. But the Bible tells us the heaven is surrounded by jasper walls, meaning those are the display. We treasure pearls, beautiful pearls. Bible tells us there's a pearly gates of heaven. It's just used as an ornament for gates. Bible tells us the love of God, the love of God compels Him for us to be saved. The love of God compels Him to make us right in His sight. The love of God gives us the privilege for that God's glory. I don't know about you, but the Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 1, for me to live is Christ and to what? To die is gain. Now what is gain in death? Is there such gain in death? Isn't it that death brings grief and suffering? Isn't that death brings pain, separation, anxiety? Well, you know, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, there is gain in death if a person is a believer of the Lord Jesus Christ. Only through that there will be gain in death. You know why? First, there will be no more tears. There will be no more pain. There will be no more sorrows. The Bible tells us the Lord is going to wipe away all the tears from our eyes. And we will be perfected in heaven. And that is the kind of glory that we're looking forward. And the Bible tells us we have that. We have that because God brought us, because of our faith, gave us that undeserved privilege that we're going to enjoy in that place called heaven, the eternal glory in heaven. And not because of our works, not because of the good things that we have done, but because we put our faith in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, in the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, who did it for you and for me. Through the Lord Jesus Christ. I kept on saying this. It is only through the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no other name used by God aside from the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for you and for me to be saved. Other than that, I don't know who can save us. There is no other way we can be saved aside from the Lord Jesus Christ. Number five. It is now. Point one, point two, point three, point four refers to our spiritual lives. Everything is about our soul. God would like to take care of your soul and my soul. And when we die, God assures we enjoy what? Eternity in heaven. We are going to rejoice in that glory days, you know, in heaven. But God doesn't want only to take care of our souls, because God knows we're still living here. Amen? Amen? So God also takes care of what? Our physical needs, our emotional needs, and everything. So in number five, it says, it is love that encouraged me in times of trouble. What does it mean? Look at verse 3. We can. Can you read that with me? We can what? Rejoice too. In what? We can rejoice when we run into prayer. problems and trials. Is there such thing as rejoicing in problems and trials? How many of you are rejoicing? Praise the Lord! I don't have money to pay my mortgage. I'm just trying to be honest, right? If there's no food on the table, how can you rejoice? There's a problem. No more money to purchase gasoline. You can go around. There's no money to pay your car. It's a difficult time. But the Bible tells us is this. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials. For we know that they help us develop endurance, and endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confidence, hope of salvation, and this hope, I want you to be mindful of this, and this hope will not lead to what? Disappointments. Why? Why it will not lead to disappointment? Why trials will not lead us into disappointments? It says here, for we know, what's the answer? For we know how dearly, how God loves us, because He has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with His love. Now, how did He show this love? He said a while ago, with His great love, He sent who? Jesus Christ, His Son. Now, I just want you to understand this. That when you put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, your soul is taken care of. Not only your soul, but your physical life is also taken care of by God. You know why? Just imagine this. If God the Father in heaven were able to give His only begotten Son for you and for me, what do we think that He's going to withhold the blessings? Hello? Just imagine this. God the Father sent His only begotten Son. And we have a problem for our provision. I don't have money. Daddy, I don't have money. That's not an issue. I gave my Son for you. I cannot give you money. Remember, I own everything. I own everything. I read an article that says like this. When you pray, when you ask God, it's not about how big your problem is, but it's how big your God is. So when we approach the throne of God, when we approach God in our prayers, let's not look upon our problems, but let's look upon how great God is. And that gives hope in us. You know why? The Bible tells us it will not lead into disappointments. God is not going to disappoint a son or a daughter or a child, because the Bible tells us He loves us dearly. Philippians 4:19, but my God shall supply all your needs. According to what? In Christ Jesus. Just imagine when we learn to trust the Lord and put our faith in the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. God takes care of everything. He assumes full responsibility, not only of our spiritual life, but also of our physical. You know, sometimes we don't fall in love with God because we fail to understand how God loves us so much. If we only learn to embrace the reality that the reason why God sent Jesus Christ to die for us is because He wants to assume everything that He has given to us from the very beginning. So we're going back to the creation of mankind. That even before God created the human beings, He created everything that man needs. And He said, I want you to enjoy every creation that I've done. Enjoy it. You want steak? I created the cow. You want pork barbecue? Pig. You want chicken barbecue? Chicken. You want eggs? Chicken. Or duck. You want fish? You don't eat meat. You want fish? The ocean is filled with fishes. You want vegetables? There's a lot. You want fruit? Men. Just imagine, now, because we fell into sin, we don't enjoy those blessings anymore. Bible tells us we're going to have difficulty to work hard for our living. But this is the catch. We cannot go back to the Father, so the Father is the one that initiated them to go to us. His love tells us, hey, I love you, my creation. I know you cannot go back to me, so I am commissioning, Son, come here. Let's talk. You know they cannot go back to me, right? Yes. You know that if I send you there, you're going to die. Yes. You're going to feel all those sins. Yes. And then Jesus said, bring it on. Because I know, Daddy, you love these people. And the only way they can go back to you is through me. So bring it on. Just imagine, he'll take care of everything. Number six, it is love that makes me friends with God. We've been discussing this, but since our friendship with God was restored by the death of his son, while we were still enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of his son. So now we can rejoice in a wonderful new relationship with God because of our Lord Jesus Christ has made us what?
Friends.
Wow, friends can mean the Lord. We're close. When we talk about friendship, we talk about what? Relationship. Let's imagine now we can establish a relationship with God just like before. Just like before. And it's because of God's love. Number seven and last. It is love that causes me to rejoice. Our rejoice, rejoice. So now we can rejoice. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because of our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends of God. We can rejoice in many ways. We can rejoice because we're going to heaven. We can rejoice even in times of suffering because we have encouragement. The Bible tells us we're going to be encouraged. He will not lead us into disappointments. Now, what are you trying to say, Pastor? Look at the impact of God in our lives. Look at the difference God gave us through Him. Look at the difference. He made a difference in our lives. We have experienced God's love. Here's the catch. The same love that God gave us is the same love that we need to give out. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So you want to make a difference in life? Listen to this, church. This is good. Okay? This is good. I'm not saying it's bad. I can give my money, praise the Lord. You give your tithes, you give your offering, praise the Lord. You can give your talents, you can play over here, praise God. Right? There's no problem with that. I'm saying there's no problem with that. Right? You can give your skills, your ingenuity that will change the history of mankind. But the difference I will make is what?
Temporary.
Now, who reinvented the light bulb? Thomas Edison. Why reinvention? Because before Thomas Alva Edison reinvented the light bulb by using a glow filament, it was already discovered by a German engineer. Right, Brian? Am I right? See? I got that on Google and Wikipedia. Kind of kidding aside. But one day, all of this will be gone. The Bible tells us, remember? The Bible tells us everything will come to pass.
There is only that one that will stand. And what is that? God's word. But it made a difference. Where we have lights, we have different kinds of lights. Now we have LED, right? We have halogen, we have HID. You know, everything comes from that same idea. But even though it changes the world, the difference is what? It's going to be temporary. Now, who invented the rotary phone? Huh? Rotary phone. Samsung. Alexander Graham Bell, right? Alexander Graham Bell. But who uses rotary phone still? Nobody. But that made a difference in terms of communication. It made communication more faster. But before the communication, you write the note, you tie it like that, and click. You know, and then someone is like, brother Dan is roaming around, and you send the dove in Bulacan. Sauteed in soy sauce and vinegar with lots of garlic. Adobo.
Thank you.
Just imagine. So it made a difference. But the difference was what? It was temporary. So if you want to make a difference in life, if you want to leave a legacy, making an impact to the lives of your friends, of your loved ones, or your relatives, you've got to think to make what? An eternal impact. You want something that will last forever. How can I make a difference, Pastor? Share God's love to others. Then I will make an eternal difference. The same love in Romans chapter 5 that God extended to us, the same love we can give out. Is that right? Amen? Just imagine this, as I was saying. You know, all of us who are migrants here in the States have loved ones back home. Or we have relatives around the corner or around the area. Yes, we can help them with money. We can send those remittances. Amen? We can send those help. But if we fail to share the gospel of salvation, the gospel of love to them, what we're doing to them is just temporary. It's nothing eternal. There's nothing eternal about that. So if God asks for their lives, what's going to happen? If they don't know the Lord Jesus Christ in their lives, that would be the most painful separation that you are going to experience in your life. I started with a friend. You have a friend, Daniel? You have a friend? The Bible tells us a friend have at all times. Just imagine, if we fail to share the Lord Jesus Christ to our friends, and time comes, they were asked by the Lord to go. How would you feel? We don't take this seriously because sometimes we don't know. But if you want to make a difference in life, give them something that will last eternity. Not only here on planet Earth. Share God's love to others, then I can help others to be friends with God. You want your friends to be friends with your God, right? Share God's love to others, then I can give them unlimited source of what? Of what? You're not only helping their souls, but you're also giving them a limited source of supply. I think that would be the best encouragement we can give our friends and our loved ones. Why? Because we're limited. We're human beings. Right? But if we introduce them to the Lord Jesus Christ, He just gave them a limited supply. Amen? Just imagine, just make a difference in the life of a person by sharing the Lord Jesus Christ. Invest in sharing God's love to that person that you love, who doesn't know the Lord Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. Invest in that. Sige na, pwede niyo na sa final thought. God made a difference in our lives through His love. Our purpose is to make a difference in the lives of others by extending God's love. The same love you and I experience from God the Father, the same love needed to be given to others as well. To close, look at Romans chapter 1, verse 14 to 17. This is what the Bible, this is what Apostle Paul tells us in Romans chapter 1. For I have an obligation, what is the word? In the King James Version, it says, I am a debtor. You know, when you are a debtor, you are obligated to pay something, right? That's the basic definition of being a debtor. It says, for I have an obligation. So let's define obligation. Is obligation voluntary?
No.
No, right? What is an obligation? It's what? It's a must. You should do. It's mandatory. So the Bible tells us, Apostle Paul taught us, that I am obligated to all what? To all people. To the civilized, and to the savage, to the educated, to the ignorant. So then I am eager to preach the good news to you, also who live in Rome. I have complete confidence in the gospel. It is what? It is God's power to save all who believe. How are they going to believe if us believers are not going to extend the love that we believe? For the gospel reveals how God puts people right with Himself. It is through faith from the beginning to end. As the scripture says, the person who is put right with God through faith shall live. Now this becomes an obligation. Church, I want you to listen to this. I want you to listen to this. When you experience God's love in your life, it now becomes an obligation. The same love also needed to go out of us and share to others. Just imagine your loved ones who are not believers. When you introduced Jesus Christ to them, you gave everything to them, both spiritual and physical. Just imagine your friends who doesn't know Jesus Christ. When you extend the same love, what you have right now, they will have as well. The benefits that you are enjoying in the hands of God, they will also enjoy. The challenge is this. Are you willing to share the same love that you have experienced from God? Will you? One thing that I have learned in my Christian life is this. There are two ways to respond. God will never force us to do anything. Amen? God will never force us to do anything. But when we are obedient to God, we harvest the consequence, which are good. We are not, we are going also to reap the consequence. It's just a matter of choice. from my own standpoint is this. I want to share God's love to others in any way I can. Not only to others, but also to my loved ones, also to my friends, also to my neighbors. You know why? Is that love. That love will make an eternal difference in the life of a person. You just don't know what's going to happen if you share the same love. You might not become very popular, but one day you share that love to others. One day someone will stand before other people and would start to testify. Not because of this man, not because of this person, I'm not going to be like this. No, I had a chance of witnessing one of the birthday celebrations of Billy Graham. I just forgot what year was that, but I was so blessed. Right? I was telling myself, Lord, I hope and I pray that one day there's one or there's two persons that would be able, when I am lying down in my coffin, now, there's one or two persons that would say, you know, I want to thank this guy because he shared Jesus Christ to me. And my life before was a mess. But because of this person, my life is now different. You know, when I was watching that, there was this one guy who was making a testimony. He said, Dr. Graham, you don't probably remember me, but I was the person who attended your crusade, and I was a drug addict. And my life was totally messed. And I don't know what to do, I want to die in prayer. But when I heard you preach the love of the Father for me, I put my trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and gave my life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And God proved himself to me. And then the camera zoomed out. He was pastoring about 7,000 people. He was pastoring 7,000 people. And he said, this is the congregation God entrusted to me. And this happens because of you. And I started to cry. I was watching on TV and I started to cry. And I was really crying so hard. And then this guy, again, testified before the camera and said, Dr. Graham, probably you remember me. I play the saxophone in your choir. I play the saxophone in your choir. I'm this guy that doesn't talk too much. I remember you when you preach and I gave my life to the Lord. And I trusted the Lord. Then the camera zoomed out again. His congregation is about 22,000 people in the church. And then I started crying again. I said, whoa. This man was lambasted by many people because of what he's doing. But when he extended the love of God to those people, he affected one person. This person affected 25,000 more. You'll never know. You'll never know. When you share that gospel of love, you'll never know whom you're going to affect. And you'll never know soon they'll be affecting more lives. Because you share the same love you have experienced from God. You'll never know. But you can make a difference. By just telling, Lord, I want to make a difference in this life. But I don't want to make a temporary difference. I want to make an eternal difference. I want to share your love to others. Let's all stand.